Dying to be Stuckmocky, Chapter 40. The Ceremony Begins. Yes, plafond, you and me. We're on a spiritual journey together, remember? Vira felt a strong urge to push her case harder with a flood of persuasive words, but something in Fahyrjeon's demeanour told her she'd said enough. Wait, was this the Stuckmocky body reading thing she was doing? The next thing you know, she'd be popping a tasty grasshopper in her mouth. Having listened to instinct, it then told her to reach out and take Fahyrjeon's enormous hand, so she did. She stared at it, cradled in her two small hands, and a flood of empathy passed through her. She forgot about the urgency of persuading her friend, and merely felt the strength of their connection and its importance to her. Silently she began to comb the orange-brown fur on the back of the hand with her fingers, gradually working her way up the wrist and forearm. When she got to a particularly stubborn tangle and had to start teasing it out, the arm suddenly pulled out of her hands and wrapped itself around her. Vira was jerked into a vigorous hug with her face pressed deeply into the thick, warm fur on Fahyrjeon's chest. As she meltingly surrendered to the smothering embrace, all she could think about was how nice the Stuckmocky smelled when it was freshly washed. Once she felt dizzy from lack of oxygen, Vira struggled to release herself, and the two encircling arms relaxed. Before she could step away, though, Fahyrjeon cupped its hands under her armpits and hoisted her up level with its face. It stared at her long and searchingly, with many unknowable emotions playing across its face. Then it sighed deeply and put her down.
I cannot stand in your way any more, Vira Hanga Fibonacci. I would merely be standing in my own way.
Fahyrjeon turned and shuffled away towards the group of sprogs, who had ceased their ballet in order to watch the strange interaction playing out. Vira had to again suppress the urge to say something. She longed to call out to her furry friend and reassure it, but she had no words that would truthfully do that. She was hurtling towards her imminent death. She knew from the emotions she was struggling to keep under control that the wrenching separation that came with death overshadowed all other feelings, and there was nothing that could ameliorate them. Vera's knees buckled under her, and she abruptly sat down on the cavern floor. With nothing left opposing her except an already doubtful Vahira, she suddenly felt the reality of what she was about to do. What if she were wrong? What if they were all wrong? What if there were nothing but blackness after death, and all these Stuckmocky were deluding themselves about souls and second parents? What if Rizenwikk were just a hypnotic trickster, or we go home when we die meant something other than she'd understood? It could just as easily be suggesting her soul's return to a spiritual community in some kind of heaven. Vira had half convinced herself to change her plans and live out a full, happy life in her clan, when Mirren's voice spoke behind her. Vira Hanka Fibonacci, what in the spirit's name are you thinking? You cannot seriously be considering this course of madness. Why did everyone suddenly feel the need to use her full name? Vira twisted around to look up into Mirren's angry face. You've been talking to Vahira, huh? Mirren sat down in front of her, blocking her view of the rehearsing sprogs, now facing each other in two lines. Indeed I have. I have been fully informed of your suicidal proposal, and I am here to tell you that you must not proceed with it. Vera's spirits did an about turn, and her dogged determination to see it through surged back into her. Maybe all she'd needed was some opposition to power her own momentum. Then it sounds like Vahira agrees with me now, she calmly asked.
Yes, and I cannot for the life of me understand its reasoning. There are any number of willing volunteers offering their souls, it seems. Why is yours the preferable choice?
Because, said Vira as she stood up, it's the choice that will start the game over. It's a complete reboot, a factory reset, and I don't expect you to understand that, but please accept it. Vira began to walk towards the carsoar rehearsal, then stopped and turned back to Mirren. If you had the chance to undo all the killing in the arena and be free of all the guilt, wouldn't you take it? She didn't wait to hear Mirren's response, but she'd already seen the anger drop from his face as she turned again to the sprogs ahead of her. They were slashing their miniature swords back and forth in a rhythmic parody of the very combat she'd orchestrated night after night on her console. The memory of how thoughtlessly she'd dispensed with her Stuckmocky opponents on her glowing screen made her want to run down the middle of the two lines of opposing sprogs and have their swords slice her in half. Why wait for the ceremony? Then she was stopped in her tracks by the realization of what she'd been seeing for some time, but hadn't registered until that moment. First of all, the long swords weren't metal. They appeared to be made of wood. Every time the sprogs slashed at each other, their swords passed right through their opponents. Or more correctly, each sprog seemed to thin out of existence momentarily as a sword neared it, then re-solidified after the sword had passed through. All except for one poor tyke on the end of the line, who was nearly in tears, and if not covered in fur, would have been seen to be covered in bruises from all the sword hits it was taking. "Are they not remarkable?" said Mirren's awed voice next to her. His tone had changed completely, and he seemed to have forgotten his anger. "Why they do not do that in the arena, I cannot understand." "Because they need each other to make it happen." She didn't know how she knew that, but she did. She was becoming more Stuckmocky by the minute, it seemed. It also seemed her notion that a carsoar was blood sport was completely wrong, and the relief she felt at discovering that almost made her knees buckle again. She watched as Fahyrjeon approached the teary-eyed sprog and convinced it to give over its sword, then escorted it to its gently smiling parent. "Mirren, if something should go wrong with my plans, promise me you'll do whatever it takes to stop the slaughter of Stuckmocky in combat." Vira felt Mirren's arm go around her shoulders. "You have my word as a gladiator." Vira turned to look at the odd expression on Mirren's face. "Or maybe as a Stuckmocky," he corrected. Vira slipped her arm around Mirren's waist and squeezed it. "Thanks. I knew I could count on you." Vira and Mirren stood holding each other as they watched Fahyra cross the cavern and approach Fahyrjeon. Vira could tell from the way Fahyrjeon slumped as the other talked to it that Fahyra was notifying her change of mind. Fahyrjeon nodded resignedly and turned towards Vira as Stuckmocky spectators began to take up their positions around the ceremonial area. Vira closed her eyes and took a deep breath.